Hi everyone, JLR here, and I've got another DIY video for you. This time I'm building a new power supply for one of the cases in my large 5U modular wall. One of the cases has a power supply that is underpowered for the modules that are in it. And so for over a year I've had one of the modules disconnected from the power supply so the rest of the modules would work. The last several I've built, I've used my custom designed rack mount plate. I call this the UPP, which stands for Universal Power Plate. Universal because it has holes drilled for several different components. Three different sizes of power supplies can be mounted, two different sizes of distribution boards. Distribution boards can be mounted at a right angle. The four holes at the end can be used for various things like banana jacks, quarter inch jacks, etc. I designed it to be universal like this, partially so it could be reconfigured easily, but also I had thoughts of making a large batch and selling them. But I'm still tweaking the design. Maybe someday it'll be finished. Warning! This video is not an all-inclusive instruction guide on how to safely build an AC to DC power supply. The supply voltage from your wall outlet is high voltage alternating current that can cause fires, serious injuries, and even death. Don't attempt this unless you fully understand what you're doing. If not, refer to a qualified technician to help you build the power supply. Shown here are a majority of the parts needed to build the power supply. Have the universal power plate, and it has multiple holes drilled to accommodate different parts. Got the large square hole for the combination AC inlet power switch fuse and EMI filter, the screws to mount it, the quick connectors for crimping on wires that go to the transformer. This is the main linear power supply unit, and it's one of the smaller size ones. Just has two mounting points to go to the plate. There's the bolts for mounting it, and there's a bolt for attaching the ground wire. This is the power distribution board and the connectors that get soldered onto it. This particular distribution board has six mounting holes. And we have the nylon standoffs and screws for attaching it to the UPP. And lastly, I've got the four banana jacks that I'm using. They go in these four holes. Plus 15, 0 volt, minus 15, and ground. If I was using a power supply that had a plus 5 volt rail, I would not use the ground and I'd have a different colored banana jack for the plus 5 volts. And that's the parts except for some wire and solder and a couple screws and other little parts that I forgot to lay out. The first thing I'll attach is the power inlet. It's not really critical what you attach first, but I just kind of went in order of the panel. Power inlet fits beautifully in that precision cut square hole. The screws I have, I just got out of my parts bin and they aren't an exact match for the holes in the power inlet. So it would have been fine, but I kind of wanted them to sit flush. So I reamed out the holes a little bit more so the taper went deeper. As you can see, this is sped up so you don't get too bored. When making these holes a little deeper, I do a little bit at a time so I don't go too deep, so then they don't sit below the level of the power inlet. And as you can see, the screws I'm using are also longer than they need to be. That's just what I had that worked. So just a screw, a lock washer, and the nut, and then tighten them down. Next step is to attach the linear power supply to the panel. And one thing that I forgot to do before I ordered the panel was to enlarge the holes that are used to mount the power supplies to the panel. So, not too big of a deal. I just have to enlarge the holes, and I'll use a stepped drill bit to do that. Makes it easy. I just had to go one size up. It's always a good idea to tape off the area that you're drilling, even if you're just enlarging a hole, because the shavings can scratch the panel. Do a quick check to make sure the hole is the right size. You don't want to go too big for a nice tight fit. And then finish it off with a deburr tool. Make sure the holes are nice and smooth. Attach the power supply with a bolt flat washer on the outside, and then on the inside a lock washer and the nut. One of the two nuts on this power supply is a little hard to get to, so I used tweezers to get the lock washer onto the bolt, and I used forceps to hold the nut to get it attached. Works pretty well. Next, I'll install the banana jacks. I use red for plus 15, black for 0 volts, white for negative 15 volts, and green for ground. I've never over-tightened one of these, but I always worry about it because they're just plastic threads, and they never get solidly tight like a metal screw would. These jacks are primarily for testing the power supply, checking to make sure the voltages are correct without having to open up the case. Something I mentioned earlier about mounting a larger distribution board, if you happen to use one of the linear power supplies that's so big there's no room for the distribution board, you can use a right angle bracket to mount the distribution board to, and use the banana jacks to attach the right angle bracket to the panel. Now I'm going to solder all the connectors onto the distribution board. The board's designed to use little blades for the input of the voltage, but instead I'm going to use screw terminals, which will make my wiring a little easier since there's two connectors per block. First step is to tack solder one pin of the connector, and then once that's done, then it's easy to apply a little pressure and then reheat the pin so the connector sits flush to the board. Once those are done, solder all the pins. You'll see I screwed up and I had one connector backwards, so I had to pull it out and redo it. One thing I didn't intend to do is, for these first few connectors, I used no clean solder, which has a flux you can leave on, but I like to clean it off anyway when I can, using rubbing alcohol. But after I did these three, I switched to water-soluble flux solder, which is much easier to clean off. You just run warm water from the tap over it and scrub it with a little brush, like an old toothbrush. Makes a much nicer looking board. To solder on the MTA connectors, you can use various techniques. trying to put several in at once and flipping it upside down usually doesn't work. You can do one at a time like that, but sometimes I like to use a small alligator clip to hold one of the pins. That way you can get one of the initial pins tack soldered. That works, but it can get a little tedious, and so I went back to just doing one at a time and letting gravity hold the board against the connector, and I got along pretty good that way. I did one row at a time and then made sure they were flush. When you're putting pressure on the connector and reheating the pin so the connector will sit flush, make sure you don't have your finger on the pin that you're reheating, otherwise it will hurt. And we've jumped ahead. Almost done soldering. And now the board's been washed nice and clean. Problem with these connectors is they're not really made to be washed because water gets underneath them. But using a towel, slamming it on the desk, using compressed air, using a heat gun, I get pretty much all the water out, and by the time it's all wired up and ready to be tested, it's dry and I've never had a problem. This next step is pretty straightforward. We're just attaching the distribution board to the panel. One thing to keep in mind is to not tighten any of the screws down until you've got all of them through the holes they need to go through. It'll make it much easier. So, almost tight. Attach all the standoffs to the panel, then put the screws through the distribution board into the standoffs, but not fully tight yet. Then I'll tighten the standoffs against the panel so they're nice and snug. And once that's done, I'll do the final tightening on the screws that hold the distribution board to the standoffs. And once that's done, take a moment to check to make sure everything is tight and in the right place. This particular power supply can operate at either plus minus 12 volts or plus minus 15 volts. And for plus minus 15 volts, you need to cut two jumpers on the circuit board. Another step I do that may or may not be necessary for your power supply build is that I cut any jumpers that connect the transformer inputs. I do this because the transformer can be configured to accept different AC input voltages. So depending on where you live, you might have 120 volts AC single phase or 220 volts dual phase. And by setting it up this way, the combo AC inlet I use can be switched externally for 120 or 220. It's fairly unlikely that I'll ever travel with my modular synth to a country that has a different AC power grid, but I did my first power supply this way, so I try to be consistent with them all. Here I'm attaching the ground wire from the AC inlet to the power supply chassis, using a quick connect on one end and a eyelet crimp connector on the other end. When using crimp connectors, make sure you use the correct size connector for the wire you're using. Otherwise, it'll either be too hard to crimp or it won't grab the wire well enough. Here I'm making the four wires that go from the AC inlet to the transformer inputs, and another ground wire that goes to the banana jack. Something I forgot to do was to add a little wire guide clip to keep things neat. And I'm numbering the wires that go from the AC inlet to the transformer so I don't get confused later on. The AC inlet I use has the terminals numbered 1 through 4, but that doesn't match up with the inputs to the transformer that are numbered 1 through 4. So you have to really pay attention and understand exactly what needs to go where. Before soldering the wires from the AC inlet to the transformer input terminals, make sure to slip a little piece of heat shrinkable tubing over the wire. So when you're done soldering, you can slip that up and shrink it down to prevent shocks. And if you forget one, like I did right about here, yeah, just unsolder your wire and add the heat shrink. Simple to do, but critically important. Any exposed areas of AC power need to be insulated. Every year there are hundreds of accidental deaths due to electrocution, so be safe, don't be sorry. I even like to insulate the fifth unused terminal on the transformer, just to be complete. Now I'm adding a couple little wire ties to make sure the wires are secure. And finally, I'm adding a wire to go from the chassis to my ground banana jack. And yes, the insulating heat shrink here is totally unnecessary, but I like to be consistent. Now I'm preparing three wires to attach to the power supply DC output terminals that will be attached to the distribution board input terminals. Some of you that are familiar with building these sorts of linear power supplies may notice I'm not taking the time to attach the remote sense terminals to the output terminals. This isn't necessary according to the documentation that comes with the power supplies. Here's an image of the related part of that power supply document. If I was to mount this power supply several feet away from the synthesizer, I would definitely use the sense lines, but in my instance, it's not necessary. And speaking of unnecessary, I'm putting heat shrink over those output terminals. It really does absolutely nothing. I just like the way it looks. Now I'll take a little time to neaten up the wiring. It's not really necessary to make neat wiring, but I think it's much easier for troubleshooting. Plus, I just prefer the way it looks. Now I'll attach the wires to the screw terminals on the distribution board. And then finally, attach the wires to the three remaining banana jacks and attach those to the distribution board. And here's some more unnecessary heat shrink tubing. Notice that I'm overstretching one end of the heat shrink so it'll fit over the banana jack and then still close in on the wire. Smooth-backed needle-nose pliers are good for doing this. And final step, route the wires, cut off the excess, strip the ends, and attach to the screw terminals. And yay, we are done.
Hey, this calls for a celebration. Come on, let's shake this town up tonight.
This took me about 3 hours to build. At least 3 hours of filming time. And here's a quick comparison of the new power supply on top and the one I'm replacing on the bottom. I've been doing the same basic design for probably 13 years now, and subtle changes over time probably have gotten a little bit neater. And I'd like to give a shout out to Richard Brewster, who gave me the basic idea to do power supplies like this. I'll put a link in the description below for his excellent site. He has lots of good DIY projects and good information. Thanks, Richard, for getting me started. Thank you.